round the throne of the Lord, hear the elders say, at the feet of the King is a constant offering. Around the throne of the Lord, they never cease to sing. At the feet of the King, there's a common thing. They cry, holy, holy Lord. So we cry, holy, holy God. At the feet of my King, round the throne of the Lord, they never get tired of it. At the feet of King Jesus,
yeah. Good morning, Greater Mount Zion. Good morning, family and friends. And if we have any new viewers with us this morning, we would like for you to click the heart there on the screen to let us know that you are with us. Amen. Amen. And that if we do have any new viewers with us, I do want to let you know we do appreciate you taking time out this morning to join us here at Greater Mount Zion on our online worship service. Amen. It's good to be with you all on this third Sunday in the month of February as we begin this journey through the season of Lent on our way to Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Amen. And as we get on this journey, during this season of Lent, I do pray and hope that you have thought about what you want to fast from. I do hope that you've taken some consideration to not only fast, but to pray. Amen. And not only that, but to also repent. Amen. And to serve our God and our King. That's what this season is all about. Amen. And so we want to get ready right now to begin our worship service. And as always, we do that by invoking the presence of the Lord wherever you may be. So if you don't mind, please bow your heads. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we thank you for another day of worship. Thank you, God, that you brought us through last week and that you brought us to this moment that we are at right now. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray that everything that's said and done in this worship service would be pleasing to you. We pray that you'll make your presence felt wherever we may be, that we may give you our best worship and our best praise. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen. Let's give God praise right where you are right now as we prepare to worship him.
John Lewis report by Nathaniel Treadway. John Robert Lewis, born February 21st, 1940, was an American politician, statesman, civil rights activist, and leader who served in the United States House of Representatives for Georgia's 5th Congressional District from 1987 until his death in 2020. He attended the American Baptist Theological Seminary in Nashville, Tennessee, and was ordained a Baptist minister. He also earned a bachelor's degree from Fisk University. Mr. Lewis was one of the Big Six leaders and at 23 was the youngest to represent the SNCC with a speech at the August 23, 1963 March on Washington. Mr. Lewis was the chairman of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee from 1963 to 1966, which campaigned against segregation and other forms of racism. Lewis was one of the original 13 Freedom Riders, which was a group of 7 blacks and 6 whites who rode buses from D.C. to New Orleans to challenge the policies of southern states along the route that imposed segregated seating on the buses, violating federal policy for interstate transportation. While in college, he participated in sit-ins at segregated restaurants in Nashville, Tennessee, which inspired others throughout the country to initiate sit-ins and protests at lunch counters. He fulfilled many key roles in the civil rights movement and its actions to help end legalized racial segregation in the United States. In 1965, Mr. Lewis led the first of 3 Selma to Montgomery marches across the Edmund Pettus Bridge. In an incident which became known as Bloody Sunday, state troopers and police attacked the marchers, including Mr. Lewis. He was arrested and jailed many times during attempts at desegregation and was a part of organizing bus boycotts and other nonviolent protests to support voting rights and racial equality. Mr. Lewis said it was important to engage in good trouble, necessary trouble, in order to achieve change, and he held by that phrase and philosophy throughout his life. He was dedicated to the discipline and philosophy of nonviolence, which he practiced for the rest of his life. On December 29, 2019, Mr. Lewis announced that he had stage 4 pancreatic cancer, and on July 17, 2020, at the age of 80, he died after a 6-month battle with the disease. Although Mr. Lewis is no longer with us in person, his work, memory, and nonviolent fight still lives on, as it has paved the way for many of the luxuries we enjoy today. May we remember him as he fought for our rights, and may we continue to fight as the war is not over. I need some clapping hands like this. Go ahead and clap your hands. We're going to do some Holy Ghost aerobics in here tonight. Come on, clap your hands. Can we get a massive rock on, y'all? Go. Come on, get your hands together. Come on, come on.
Amen. If you know God's been good to you, you ought to stand up. Amen. Amen. I hope you were standing during that song, giving God praise, because brothers and sisters, we must admit God has been very good to us. Amen. Amen. So just give him some praise right now, just thanking him for being good to you. And if you didn't stand up during the song and you're able to, why don't you stand up right now and just tell God thank you. Amen. For being good to you. Amen. Beloved, I also want to take the time to thank Brother Nathaniel Treadway for doing our Black History Moment. I appreciate him taking the time out to do that for us. Amen. So thank you so much, Brother Nathaniel Treadway. Well, beloved, it's prayer time now. And as we get ready to go to the Lord in prayer, as always, we remember our sick and our shut-in. We want to also pray for those who've asked us to pray for them. Pray for those who we know are not feeling well or maybe have had some health issues this past week. Pray for those who still, who may be battling this COVID virus. Amen. Amen. And pray that God will continue to work to bring it under control, that he will continue to work through medicine and through the vaccine to bring this virus under control in the land. I would even say get bold enough, pray and ask God to just remove it. Amen, because we know that he is able to. I do want to ask that you continue to pray for our church here at Greater Mount Zion as we continue to seek God's direction on when we should think about gathering and coming back together. Amen. Continue to pray for us in that area. Pray that God will continue to provide us with that which we need and to continue to supply our needs here at Greater Mount Zion. I also want to ask that you continue to pray for the city of Milwaukee. Amen. And for all that's going on in these streets here, pray for our city, pray for our city officials, and then pray for our country. Pray for the United States. People are hurting right now. People are, some folks don't have food, and we have politicians who are just going around in a circle. Amen. They're just kicking a can down the road, and they need to get busy and get focused on helping the American people, those who voted to put them in office. Then I want to actually pray for the state of Texas. I'm pretty sure you've been hearing about what has been going on there. And please understand, brothers and sisters, it is of not the people there who are suffering, but it is of the politicians' own doing while Texas is in the state that it's in as far as its electrical grid is concerned. Amen. And its power and energy is concerned. It is of their politicians' own doing. Amen. And we need to pray that the Lord would step in and to help them recover down there in Texas. Folks don't have light, they don't have heat, and they're burning everything in their fireplaces trying to keep warm. Some folks have died, amen. And so I just want to ask you, please pray for the state of Texas, amen. And then pray for yourself. Pray that the Lord will continue to take care of you and your family. Pray that he will supply you with what you need. And then ask the Lord to bless you. If there's something you've been asking him for or talking to him about, ask God to show up and bless you. Amen. Amen. So if you don't mind, please bow your heads. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we come to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father, just praying and asking that you would forgive us of our sins and please have mercy on us. We pray, God, that you would wipe the slate clean in our lives. And that during this season of Lent, Father, that you would move us and help us to repent of our sin and to turn to you. Because we know you said in your word that if we confess our sins, that you would forgive us, Father. And so in the name of Jesus Christ, we seek your forgiveness right now. And then, Father, we also pray and lift up our sick and our shut-in to you, God, asking you, Lord, to continue to be with them, to watch over them, and then let them know in the way that only you can that you're still with them, God, that you're still providing them enough grace that is sufficient. We pray, Father, for others who we know that are experiencing health issues, those who have been in some pain or maybe they just didn't feel well. We pray right now, God, that you would touch their bodies, Lord. And for those whose bodies you've touched and made feel well, we give you praise for that right now. We thank you, God, that you considered them, that you helped them to feel better. We pray, Father, those who may be still dealing with this virus that's in the land, we ask you, Father, to help them, God. Give them the strength that they need and bring about a healing in their life. And Father, we pray for those who've lost loved ones this past week. We just ask you, God, to give them the strength and comfort that they need, Father. And then, God, as we come to you, we pray right now for the folks in Texas. Pray, God, that you would have mercy on them, that you would restore the power to those cities and to those homes so those families, God, can be warm and have some sense of normalcy back in their lives. Pray for those families who've lost loved ones due to carbon monoxide poisoning and other ways of death. We just ask you to give them the strength and comfort they need, God, as they go through what they're going through. We pray for those leaders of the state of Texas, asking you, Lord, that you would touch their hearts and minds, and help them to turn away from their selfish ways for the benefit of the people that they serve. And then, God, we pray for this city we call Milwaukee. Pray for the state of Wisconsin, and we ask you, God, to touch this place. Touch it in a way, God, that we can all come together and get along. Touch the leaders, God, the politicians who've been elected to serve, touch their hearts and minds that they will do the best for the people, that they will do the will of the people, God, not their own. And we pray for our world, God. We lift up these United States and we lift up every country that's in this land. Praying right now in the name of Jesus Christ, God, that you would have mercy on us. Because we understand, God, we are not what you intend for us to be. We understand, Lord, we walked away from you. We understand we turned to our own way instead of following yours. And so we just pray and ask right now in the name of Jesus Christ, Father, that you would have mercy on us down here. And then, God, we pray for those who are watching this service this morning. Pray, Father, whatever need they have that you would provide. God, if they're going through something, help them to make it through, God. If they're feeling some kind of way, God, if they're feeling like no one loves them or care about them, let them know that you love them and that you care about them, Father. And then, God, although we come to you all the time just asking you to do so much for us, God, sometimes we forget to tell you thank you. But on this morning, we don't want to do that, God. We want to tell you thank you right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, for all you've been doing for us. Thank you, God, for watching over us and taking care of us. Thank you, God, for putting food on our tables, putting clothes on our backs, God, for giving us shelter. Thank you for keeping us warm, God. Thank you for family. Thank you for the love of family. Thank you, Father, for our church, for the people and the families that make up our church. Thank you, God, for all that you do for us. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, we want to get ready to receive our announcements. Amen. And then after our announcements, we will have the opportunity to worship God in our giving. Amen. Amen. And so before we get ready to receive our announcements and our offering, I do want to pray for our offering. And then after that, we will receive our announcements. So if you don't mind, please bow your head. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for what's about to be received. We thank you for the givers, God. We ask right now in Jesus' name that you would touch them and bless them, Father, as they worship you through giving. We pray, Father, that they would give to you in the way that you instructed in your word, God, that they would give in the form of a tithe and an offering. And we pray, Father, that what is received here at Greater Mount Zion, that it will be used, Father, for the furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ and for the building of your kingdom. For it is in Christ's name that we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, let us receive our announcements. Amen. Beloved, how many of you know that we are in the hands of Jesus, and that's where we will remain? Amen. That's what the song is talking about us being in the hands of Jesus. It's talking about our eternal security. We are in his hands, and no one shall pluck us out of his hand. Amen. Amen. Somebody should have been up shouting on that song. Amen. Knowing that now that you are in Jesus' hand, you will remain. Amen. I want to thank Bob Carlyle for that song. Amen. That's one of my top two. Amen. As far as gospel or Christian songs. Amen. In the hands of Jesus. But beloved, thank you all for participating in the offertory period. And I do want to thank all of you who were a part of our Ash Wednesday service this past Wednesday. Thank you all for joining in and tuning in. I really appreciate that. I love Ash Wednesday service. Amen. Amen. Ash Wednesday is not, you don't see that in many of our Baptist churches. Amen. But here at Greater Mount Zion and in some other Baptist churches, we do celebrate Ash Wednesday and look forward to the season of Lent as we move toward Resurrection Sunday, where we celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ being raised from the grave. Amen. Well, beloved, if you don't mind, please bow your head. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for this preaching moment that has arrived. And we thank you for a word that you've provided. We just pray now, God, that you will speak to our hearts and minds. We ask and we invite Holy Spirit right now, God, to just come in, Lord, and take over. We pray right now, Lord, that you would help us to understand your word. That you would help us to see it, help us to hear it, help us to be changed by it. I pray, God, that you would use my mind, my tongue, and my heart, and help me to proclaim your word with power and conviction, that you might be glorified on this day. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the Gospel according to Mark. Mark chapter 1, beginning at verse 14 and ending at verse 15. Just two verses. Mark chapter 1, beginning at verse 14 and ending at verse 15. If you don't have your Bibles, please know there is the Bible tab there for our new viewers. There's a Bible tab there. You can click and choose whatever Bible you want to use. I use the Holman Christian Standard Bible. But you are free to use whatever Bible, or whatever version rather, that you would like to use. And then also to our new viewers, please know there's a notes tab. And if you click on that, there are some notes that just kind of gives an outline of today's sermon. Amen? Amen. But Mark chapter 1, beginning at verse 14, and this is what you will find there. It says, after John was arrested, Jesus went to Galilee, preaching the good news of God. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Amen. Beloved, for a few moments. I want to talk about the message. The message. Amen. My friend, our text for this morning finds Jesus at the beginning of his Galilean ministry. As a matter of fact, the two verses that have been selected showcase the theme of the ministry of the Lord Jesus. While Jesus Christ was on the earth, he did many amazing things. He fed multitudes with a handful of bread and fish. He healed every kind of disease imaginable. He cast out demons. He delivered people from Satan's grip. He even raised people from the dead. The ministry of Jesus was a ministry of the spectacular. Amen. However, as spectacular as Jesus' ministry was, it is his message that was most important. Many times we read about the miracles of Jesus and we get caught up in the event but miss the message. We read the Gospels and our souls get thrilled when we read about the miracles he performed. Yet the most powerful thing about the earthly ministry of Jesus was not what he did, but it's what he said. And beloved, understand that his miracles were secondary to his message. Amen. When Jesus appears in the Gospel of Mark, he comes preaching the word of God. He appears with a message for all who will hear him. And even though his message was delivered over 2,000 years ago, it is still relevant and powerful today. Even though he died on the cross and was raised, his message still lives on. His message has been preached countless of times down through the ages. His message is still being preached all over this world. It is a message as fresh as today's headlines. It is a message that is more relevant than anything that's happening in our world today. It is a message that must be preached, and it is a message that needs to be heard. It needs to be heard, beloved, because we have too many people dying without having a relationship with Jesus Christ and going to hell. It needs to be heard because there are too many false teachers and false preachers handing out false hope. It needs to be heard because our world is in a mess, and the only way for it to get better is if we adhere to his message. It needs to be heard because it is the only message that admits one into an intimate relationship with God the Father. And my brothers and my sisters, if the truth be told, this message needs to be heard because for many believers, their lives are tore up from the floor, and they need to hear this message again. Are you with me? And so as we look at our text, survey the message that Jesus came proclaiming, I want us to see three especially important things that his message contains. Amen. The first thing we see is his message contained good news. When we look at the structure of Mark chapter 1, it begins by announcing Jesus Christ. Verse 1, it says, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Beloved, this was somewhat of an introduction of Jesus. There's a book I've been reading titled Say It, Celebrating Expository Preaching in the African American Tradition. And in that book, Dr. Charlie Dates tells the story of being invited to preach. Right before he got up to preach, he said a person was introducing him and was sharing his education in academic ministry. He was giving out all the accolades and all the things that Dr. Dates had done. Dr. Dates said as the man was telling all about him, he said all of a sudden, a man from the crowd shouted, yes, but can he preach? You see, beloved, we give long introductions, amen. We want to give the life story. We want to tell all about the person that's about to mount the pulpit and proclaim the word of God. And many times, folks who are sitting in the pews, they are saying, we don't care about all that. All we want to know is, can he preach? But Mark doesn't do that. Amen. Mark gives a very short introduction. Mark just says the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And that was enough right there to let anybody know that he could preach. Amen. And that he was coming to preach. And it was enough to let folks know who he was. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Well, from there, Mark introduces us to John the Baptist, who would be a forerunner for Jesus. Then he carries us forward to Jesus' baptism, where we see God's approval of him. Amen. Then it transitions to his temptation by Satan in the wilderness. And now he's ready for ministry. And so verse 14 tells us that after John was arrested, Jesus went to Galilee preaching the good news of God. The setting of our text is centered around the imprisonment of John the Baptist. John the Baptist was arrested because he dared to preach truth to power. Herod, the Roman appointed king, had married a woman named Herodias, who was his brother Philip's wife. John rebuked Herod, called his actions a sin. Herod arrested John, threw John into prison. John was later beheaded in that prison some 16 months later. So with these few words, Mark gives us the time frame for the beginning of our Lord's most public ministry in Galilee. And as Jesus went into Galilee, the text says that he went in preaching the good news of God. The King James Version said preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. Now the word preaching, beloved, means to carry out the office of a herald. A herald is one who came with important news from the king. Amen. He was to be heeded and he was to be respected. I need to say that again. I said a herald was one who came with important news from the king. He was to be heeded and he was to be respected. Amen. His message was to be obeyed without question. And when Jesus came, he came declaring. the message of God. My brothers and my sisters, there are many preachers in our world, but understand they are not preaching unless they are delivering the message of God. They are not preaching unless they are delivering the message of God. Let me show this to you. Paul, in his letter to a young preacher named Timothy, wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, "I solemnly charge you before God and Christ Jesus, who is going to judge the living and the dead, and because of his appearing and his kingdom, proclaim the message," or preach the word, "persist in it, whether convenient or not, rebuke, correct, and encourage with great patience and teaching." The good news that Jesus was preaching was the gospel of the kingdom of God. It was a message of hope, beloved. The Jews knew from the preaching of the Old Testament prophets that God would one day establish his kingdom in this world. Those ancient preachers told of the wonders of that coming day in vivid and glorious terms. They spoke of a king who would reign like David and defeat all the enemies of God. They wrote about a king who would be like Solomon, who would usher in a time frame of prosperity and peace. They wrote of a day when the deserts would bloom like the Garden of Eden. They talked of the lion and the lamb lying down together. They looked to a day when food would be bountiful, disease, war, and poverty would become extinct. The prophets told of a time when a man of 100 years would still be considered a child. They were looking to a time when all the nations of the world would gather themselves together in Jerusalem, and they would all worship Jehovah God. They looked forward to that time. And so Jesus came preaching a message of hope to a people trapped in despair. Their religion had ceased to have power. Their leaders were corrupt and self-serving. Their nation had long since lost its glory. Sound familiar? They were a people trapped in lives of hopelessness and desperation. They were hungry for a message of hope. Brothers and sisters, folks today are hungry for a message of hope. Folks today need to hear a message of hope. Folks are wondering, hopeless in our world today, and they need to hear a message of hope. And that message of hope is the message that Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago went into Galilee preaching. And beloved, this is the message that Jesus was preaching. And I'm here to tell you, it was good news. Well, somebody could use some good news today, just as it was in Jesus' day. We are living in times when people need to know that there is hope. We are living in the midst of hopeless and a desperate hour. People are looking for answers, and they're looking in all the wrong places. They need to hear the message. They need to hear the good news of the kingdom of God. They need to hear the message of hope that is able to help them make it through these perilous times we are in. Some people are waiting to see when the next stimulus check is coming. And for them, that's good news. But beloved, what happens when the stimulus is gone? What happens when it disappears like vapor? What happens when it's 0.00 in the account? What happens when the stimulus is gone? Well, beloved, they need to hear the good news of the message. They need to hear what Christ was preaching as he was going through Galilee. They need to hear the good news of the kingdom of God. Well, beloved, the second thing we see about this message that Jesus was preaching, and that is, it was right on time. In the A clause of verse 15, Jesus begins his message by saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Put yourself in the text. Put yourself in Galilee, standing on the side of the road. And here comes Jesus preaching, and he says this to them: the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Well, beloved, this phrase communicates a sense of urgency because the message which Jesus now heralded in Galilee was that God's hour had struck. The time to which all the Old Testament had looked forward to. God's reign upon earth, a concept familiar from the prophets, was about to begin. So now the time is fulfilled. The appointed time that was predestined by God has arrived, which underscores the fact that Jesus' message was right on time. My friends, understand, the word time in our text carries with it the idea of a favorable season of action. In other words, this was a golden opportunity for Jesus' hearers. Jesus, in this message, was preaching for immediate life change among his hearers. He was calling them to come to him right now. Look at this. He told them, the kingdom of God has come near. The hearer of Jesus' message was seeing prophecy fulfilled before their very eyes. So they should not delay, but they should turn to Jesus immediately. Well, beloved, there is still a sense of urgency today. The time has been fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. And just as Jesus was encouraging the hearers during the time in our text to turn to him, the same is expected of us today. Jesus beckons us to come and give our lives to him. It doesn't matter what you've done. Jesus wants you to come. Doesn't matter where you've been. Jesus wants you to come. Doesn't matter what your life's been like. Jesus wants you to come. Doesn't matter who you've been with, who's against you, or who's for you. Jesus wants you to come. And beloved, understand, your coming to Jesus will always be right on time. It will be right on time because you could run out of time. And so if you're viewing our online service this morning and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then now is the time. Now is the right time, and this message is right on time for you to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Word of God tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 2, for he said, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I secured thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. The message that Jesus heralded needs to be heard. It contained good news of the kingdom of God. His message was right on time. And finally, beloved, the message that Jesus proclaimed requires a response. Look at this. At the close of verse 15, Jesus says, repent and believe in the good news. Listen at that. Repent and believe in the good news. Jesus proclaimed a message of good news concerning the kingdom of God. And he let his hearers know that the kingdom of God that they were waiting for was near. The time had arrived, and now it required a response in order for them to receive the benefits of the good news of Jesus' message. They had to respond by repenting and believing in the good news. You see, beloved, repent and believing reveal the heart of Jesus' message. To miss either is to miss it all. To bypass one or the other is to miss out on the power of God's salvation. The word repent in the context of our text means to have a change of mind that results in a change of action. When a person repents of their sin, they change their minds regarding the nature of sin. Sin is no longer something to be desired, pursued, or held on to. Sin is seen as it really is, dark, dangerous, and offensive to God. Sin is no longer something to be enjoyed. Did y'all hear me? That when you repent, sin is no longer seen as something to be enjoyed. As a matter of fact, it becomes something to be avoided. It is not seen as a source of pleasure anymore, but as a pathway to destruction, death, and hell. Would Jesus, in his message, cause his hearers to repent, to have a change of heart about sin? The late Curtis Hudson said, there is no doubt that all men from Adam on have had to repent in order to have a right relationship with God. But not only must Jesus' hearers respond by repenting, Jesus, in his message, said they must also believe. Now that word believe in the double Greek means to think to be true. Since Jesus' message announces the advent or arrival of a new kingdom, then belief in the good news entails allegiance to the new king. Amen. Well, my friends, Jesus, in his message, was encouraging those who heard his message to accept it as true. When this message of Jesus, which is a simple message, is received as the truth and believed on with sincerity from the heart, then salvation is the result. In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, it says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. The message Jesus preached is a message that is life-changing for everyone who hears it and believes it. But for his message to be effective in your life, you must respond to both parts. There must be repentance, and you must believe. You see, my friends, repentance prepares the heart for belief in the good news. Repentance deals with the sin question. Repentance shows the willingness of the sinner to turn away from sin. And beloved, please know, there can be no salvation apart from genuine repentance. Let me say that again. There can be no salvation apart from genuine repentance. If you are not willing to let go of your sins, you cannot exercise genuine faith in Jesus Christ. Therefore, you cannot be saved. To make a profession without genuine repentance of sin is dangerous, beloved. It's dangerous because it shows contempt for the gospel and for the cross of Jesus Christ. Let me see if I can help somebody this morning. You might be hearing this and you might be of another mindset, but let me see if I can help you with this. You see, to come to Jesus without wanting to change is an oxymoron. It's a contradiction in terms, because when we come to Jesus, we come seeking to be transformed from the way we are to the way he wants us to be. It's an oxymoron to want to come to Jesus and remain the way you are. Jesus, not wanting to repent. The simple fact that the word repentance carries with it the idea of turning from sin and back to God says that repentance is necessary for one to be saved. So to come to Jesus wanting to remain the way you are is an oxymoron. It's a contradiction in terms, beloved. Because when we come to Jesus, we come seeking to be transformed, to be recreated on the inside, to be changed from the way we are to the way he wants us to be. And beloved, that demands we repent and believe the message of the good news. Well, my brothers and my sisters, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has done and is still doing some amazing things. But it is what he says that makes all the difference in the world. Amen. His message of the good news of the kingdom of God is what led us into his saving grace. Oh, beloved, the good news, which is the gospel of Jesus Christ, tells us about the grace of God. It tells us God sent his only begotten Son to die on an old rugged cross for the sin of humanity. And it's not because we deserved it. It's not because we earned it. It's not because we gave enough money to get it. But it is because of the unmerited favor of God. It's because of God's grace that he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for all humanity. The message, beloved, it tells us that on the third day, God raised Jesus from the dead. It tells us that right now, that he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. And it tells us that one day, beloved, that he's coming again. My friend, that's the message. It's a message that contains good news. It's a message that's right on time. It's a message that requires a response. It's a message that lets us know that if we repent and believe the good news, we shall be saved. Salvation is not in miracles, beloved. It's not in signs, but it's in the message. It's in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And beloved, I don't know about you, but I'm glad I received that message. I'm glad that I repented of my sins. I'm glad that I believe in the good news. And since I've done that, I'm now saved for all eternity. I'm in the hands of Jesus. Well, I will forever remain. Nobody can kick me out. Nobody can talk me out. Nobody can push me out. It's because of the message of the good news of the kingdom that I'm in the hands of Jesus. Well, I will forever remain. And if the truth be told, if you have repented and believed in the good news of the kingdom, you're in the hands of Jesus with me. We're all sailing together on our way to heaven. That's the message. It's good news. It was right on time, and it required a response. Aren't you glad for the message? Aren't you glad Jesus preached the message of good news of the kingdom of God? I don't know about you, but I'm glad that he preached the good news. I'm glad that I heard the good news. I'm glad that I received the good news. I'm glad that I responded to the good news, because now that I responded to the message of Jesus, I'm on my way to glory, and nobody can stop me. Thank God for the message. Thank God for the ministry of Jesus. Thank God for the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the message, beloved. Out of all the things we see Jesus do, the miracles, everything that he's done, it is the message that saves one's soul. Amen. Amen. Let's give God praise. Give God thanks. Amen. Well, beloved, we want to take time right now to extend Jesus Christ. There may have been someone tuned in to our service. You don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Well, I'm here to tell you, he can be your Savior if you just believe the message. If you believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sin, believe that God raised him from the grave. Believe that one day he's coming back. That when he comes, he's coming to take you to live with him forever. And that's salvation. Repent of your sins. Turn to God and let God know you're sorry. Receive Christ's death on the cross for your sin. That was payment for your sin. And it wasn't payment to the devil. No, it was a payment that satisfied the wrath of God on your life. Amen. So if you believe that message, the gospel of Jesus Christ, Christ will save you right now for all eternity. You will be in the hands of Jesus where you will forever remain. Amen. Amen. If you want to do that, I want to ask you to click the I Commit My Life to Jesus hand that just came up. That will take you to our website where you will see the plan of salvation and where you will be able to communicate with us there. Either shoot us an email or give us a call here at the church. Or if you're not ashamed, and I hope you're not, you can let us know in the chat area who you are and about the decision you just made, or you can click the prayer button and you will come into the host area where I am, where we can talk about the decision you just made. Amen. Well, maybe you're watching, you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you believed and accepted the message, amen, but you don't have a church home where you can serve and worship Him. Well, I'm here to tell you, Greater Mount Zion can be that place for you today. And we will ask you to do the same. Click that hand and take you to our website where you can send us a message or call us at the church. Let us know in the chat area or click the prayer button. And you can come into the host area where I am so we can have a conversation about the decision you just made. For those of you who know Christ, have a church home as we get ready to pray. Pray right now that someone will surrender their lives to the Spirit of God. Give their life to Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we come now in the name of Jesus Christ, thanking you for Holy Spirit and thanking you for your word, God. Thanking you for the message of the good news of the kingdom. Pray right now that if someone doesn't know you in the pardon of their sins, pray now that they would give their life to you by receiving Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We also pray if there's someone who's watching that doesn't have a church home. They live in our area here in Milwaukee, or maybe they live out of state and they want to become a part of our church family here at Greater Mount Zion. We just ask you to touch their hearts, touch their minds right now, God. Allow Holy Spirit to move up on them. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, Father. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, thank you all so much for being a part of our worship service this morning. I do pray that something was said that will help you as you journey through this season of Lent, heading toward that day where our Lord and Savior was raised from the grave. Amen. Amen. As you all know, I always say, please, please don't stumble into Resurrection Sunday. And what I mean is during this season of Lent, don't just go about everything as usual and then all of a sudden show up Resurrection Sunday. Amen. But as you go through this season of Lent, practice the principles of fasting, of praying, of serving, amen, of giving. Practice these principles, amen. Fill whatever you're fasting from, as I said before, fill it with something that's going to help you grow spiritually and in your relationship with God, amen, amen. Do that as we go through this season of Lent. And then please know, we still have the Lenten devotionals. We still have some available. If you want to hold one for you, come by the church and pick it up. Please call the church and let us know. Shoot me an email, amen. But please let us know so that we can have one for you. And you can come by and get them. We've already started reading them, and I'm here to tell you we have some good writers who are writing some good devotionals during this season of Lent. And so I do pray that you get one for yourself. Amen. Amen. Prayer meeting will be tomorrow at 6 p.m. We will be back in Bible study on this coming Wednesday. Teachers meeting will also be this Wednesday at 6 p.m., Bible study at 7. And then remember, Sunday school is on Saturday at 10 a.m. And I do want to encourage the women of Greater Mount Zion to support our women's ministry, the Wonderful Women of Faith. Their chat and chew will be the first Saturday in March, March 6th. And I do pray that you will take time to attend that and be a part of that. Amen. I've attended it, and I'm a pastor and I'm the male, but I still attend it because I do like it. They have some fun and they do some great things. So ladies, I do pray that you will continue to support the church and be a part of that ministry. Amen. 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 Well, let us close. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we thank you for the message. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sin. We thank you for loving us, for keeping us, God, and for saving us. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God and sweet communion of Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us now and forever. Let the people of God say, amen. Amen. God bless you, beloved. We love you.
Places our God where we may be. Let